everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. We're here today with medium Frank Andrews. Frank, thank you so much for joining us today. Oh. This is very exciting for us.
It's my pleasure. No, I enjoy doing this. It's very, you know, exciting. It's interesting because you said the word medium. You know, it's funny because, let's say, in different places, if I was in England, they call me a medium. When I'm in Hong Kong, they call me a fortune teller.
Okay.
On the West Coast, they were saying I was a channeler, and then over here in New York, I'm a psychic, so take your pick, you know.
But so is there a big difference? What do you consider yourself?
Well, it is a difference. It is. There's a lot of difference. First of all, a medium, and that's a big, big thing these days, is the people who kind of go into a trance, and they talk, and they see the dead. Now, I've done that, but that's not my way. People will call me and they say, my husband died, could you please get in touch with him? And I say, no, I can't do that. So if it happens, it happens. And I have amazing experiences. That's why I know it does work, because it did happen to me. When someone came in the room, and there was a woman, I tell you very briefly, that she came. She was about, let's say, 55 years old. And she sat down, and every time a ghost appears, if you want to call it that, or a spirit, it's always in that corner over there. So this woman, she came, she sat there, and I saw this young man standing there. He was about 17. And I said to her, did you lose a son? And she said, no. I said, oh, because there's a spirit in the room who's very young, about maybe 16, I would say 17 years old. And then I watched as he walked around the table, and he stood right there. And I looked at him.
Is he here now?
No, he's not here
okay.
now. Probably upstairs.
Okay.
So I said, to myself in my head, I go, who are you? Again, it's here, not like I just said it out loud.
Right.
And he said, tell her it's Michael. And I said, he wants to tell me his name is Michael. She goes, no, I don't know any Michael. And then he kind of smiled, and he went, oh. He said, all right, tell her it's Mike, and I died in the garage. He wants me to tell you that his name is Mike, and he died in a garage. Oh, my God. She started crying and crying. And she said, I can't believe it. I haven't thought of that boy in all these years. It was my first boyfriend.
Oh, wow.
Now, she was 55 years old.
Wow.
Or 52, something like that, somewhere between, let's say, 50 and 55. And so here's this guy who's still 17. So after that, she left, and after the reading, and I sat here, and he came back, and I said, I have a question to ask you. And he looked at me, and I said, first of all, where did this all go? And he said, all I remember is I went into the garage and I turned on the ignition. He didn't say he committed suicide, but he did. And he said, and I fell asleep. And the next thing I know is I wake up and I'm in your room here.
Wow.
So there was that gap of all those years. And he said, I guess you're the only one who can see me or talk to me. And he actually stayed around for a few years, and I got to learn a little bit more and more about the other side, so to speak. And it was funny because I work out, and I have a trainer, and he would come, and he'd go, hi, Mike, as though he knew him. And in fact, one time he was very funny. My trainer says, let me offer Mike a beer. And he says, no, I can't. He's underage. And that got a chuckle out of him. But it was really like having another person in the house. He would come, he would go. The interesting thing is the dog never reacted. A lot of times dogs or cats, you see them get crazy when there's something like that around. But this dog was very laid back.
So it didn't bother you that there was a spirit living with you?
No. I mean, there was more than that through the years. But
like what other kind of activities have you had in the house?
Well, one time, again, I had, I haven't done it in years. This guy would come over, and he was a client of mine, and he was a masseuse. And he would do it on the third floor. He, you know, he was a Ralpher, where they go really deep, you know. And I'd fall asleep, even though he's banging away. I thought, I'd look to see if there were black and blue marks. And he wanted a glass of water. And I said, look, why don't you go downstairs, because the filtered water is in the refrigerator down there, and I don't want to walk down there. So he said, okay, and he went down. And then about a few minutes later, when he comes up, he said, oh my God, I just saw a ghost in the hall. And he described this very tall man with a cigar and kind of a big, tall, black hat, very much like Abraham Lincoln, you might say. Okay. And it's interesting because other people had seen him, this spirit. And he said, I don't see ghosts. I said, well, how do you know it was that? He said, well, he was in the hall downstairs. And I said to the guy, can I help you? And with that, he said, it disintegrated right in front of me. So I said, well, I guess you saw him. Some people, I don't like to tell people, because I love when they say they saw it and then they describe what they saw. And they say, yes, other people have said that. For example, there were three women sitting back there in my garden room. And when I went to talk to them, they said, oh, we saw your grandmother. And I laughed. I said, oh, really? And they go, yes. And she was very sweet. She smiled and then she disappeared. She went away. And they do something, which I won't tell you, because if somebody sees this, I'd love for them to see this ghost and tell me what happened.
Oh, okay.
Rather than telling you, because I don't want to plant something in their mind.
Right.
Okay, it was a kind of a gesture that she did. And they all said the same thing. And I told them, I said, there's nobody in the house. They didn't believe me. So I took them through the house. And they said, you mean we saw a ghost? I said, yeah. You saw a ghost. Yeah, so...
So then you consider yourself more of a psychic.
Yeah, I try to feel like what's about to happen. Okay, everybody asks me about John Lennon. And in the case with Yoko Ono was here, when she was about to leave, I said, wait, there's one more thing. And I said, your husband, and I went like this. I didn't know who she was, and she didn't believe me, I don't think. You know, and when she told me her name, that didn't mean much to me. And I kept saying J, the initial J. And then she said, well, my husband... John Lennon, and she must have thought I was a nutcase, because I said, Lennon, really? How do you like Russia? I thought it was like the grandson, you know, Lennon. And she said, no, the Beatle, John Lennon, dumb me, go, well, wait a minute, there's Ringo, and I know there's a Paul. I don't know the names of the other two. I never bought a Beatle album.
Really?
Really. In fact, when I told him that, he said, that's refreshing.
So they were both here or just...
No, just her, okay. Just her. So when she was about to leave, and I said to her, your husband doesn't have a happy ending. And I said, he sleeps in blood. And actually, that's how he actually died. The blood actually just drained right out of him.
And then what did she say to you when you told her that? Did she just think
she
you were
didn't
crazy?
React.
Did she...
Well, you know, what do you do? Unfortunately, she told him what I said. See, that's why I don't want to do even tape recording, because I'll get a jealous wife who'll call me on the phone and I'll say, I just found a tape that you read for my husband, and what's this? I'm not a bitch. You know, you can just hear it. And he's got a girlfriend? And I go, I don't know who your husband is. And she said, come on, you've known him. He's been coming to you for 30 years.
Wow.
And I know you've gone out to dinner. And I hear you on the tape saying, oh, let's the three of us will go out tomorrow for dinner. So I know you know the story. And I said, I'm sorry, I don't remember your husband. Hang up. So that's why I don't want a tape record.
Right, that makes sense.
Because then they get crazy. See, if I don't mind it, if they play it for themselves, it might help them. But when somebody else hears it, that's when the problem is.
And do you have, when you started getting this gift and you realized you could make a career out of it?
No, I didn't do that. No, I never realized that. Basically, what happened was when I was a little boy, I grew up in Buffalo, and I saw a ghost. That was the first thing that happened. I didn't know it was a ghost. I knew it was a woman that I knew and thought she was very much alive. So I said... I can remember like yesterday, I must have been about maybe 9 or 10. And I said, you're so beautiful. And I know that she was rather plain Jane, so to speak. But there was something wonderful about her in her soul. And I said, you're so beautiful. And why did you come to see me? And she said, I came to say goodbye. And then all of a sudden, all these little sparkles, and she was gone. It was like a firecracker going off. So then in the morning when I was having breakfast, my mother went in the other room and answered the phone. In fact, in those days we had a party line. I know, you pick up the phone and somebody would be talking. Imagine that. And I mean, the cell phone was like, what are you kidding me? What was that? That was science fiction. They didn't even think about that then. So she went in the other room and came back, and I could see the look on her face was really very down. And she said, guess who died last night? And I said, Grace. And she goes, how do you know? I said, I saw her. She was in my bedroom. And my mother said, oh, you saw a ghost. Don't tell everybody. They'll think you're crazy.
Did your parents support you in your gift? Or did
they, you know, that word which you just said, people say power, they say gift. I don't know. They didn't think of it as anything. I mean, my father, people would call him on the phone and say, who's going to win in the box? My father was very into boxing. He loved boxing. He thought I was going to become a pugilist. Can you imagine? So he would say, oh, so-and-so will knock him down in the eighth round. So-and-so will knock him out in the third round, or it's going to be a draw. So my father was very into boxing. And I said, how do you know these things? And he said, oh, I know. And my mother, she was on the phone. Women would call her constantly. Well, what do you think? Is he going to marry me? My mother would, get rid of that bum. You know, he cheats on you. And one day I said, what are you, a detective? I mean, how do you know all these things? And she says, hey, you just know. See, they thought in their mind it was just something that everybody had. You know, and of course, my grandparents were originally from Sicily. And I think people in that part of the world, you know, seemed to have that other extra sense, you know. So they never thought of it as anything. And it wasn't me until I came to New York. And the year was 1959, and I met the original Auntie Mame, the one that her nephew wrote the book about. Her name was Marion Tanner, and she lived at 72 Bank Street in Greenwich Village. And I met her, and she said, oh, you're very psychic. I didn't even know the word. I was, what, at that time, about 18, 19, something like that. And I didn't even know what the hell she was talking about. And she said, what sign are you? And again, I had no idea what she was talking about. So then, as time went on, I began meeting what I call my teachers, these wonderful people. They were all in their 70s, and they were all in their 80s. And unfortunately, I only had just so many years before they passed on.
Right.
And now I'm up there. So, but it was an amazing experience. I mean, one was, well, you would call her a Chandler, and she was also a medium. A Chandler is like as if something from out there, they call it an entity rather than a dead spirit, may come through her and speak through her. And I remember sitting in one of her sessions when she was talking to someone high in the Himalayas, and in from Tibet, and she said, in this deep voice, she says, I have to go, the Chinese are coming, they're coming. And it's almost like we could hear all this commotion, and then she just put her head down, and then she was back to herself. And she never knew what she said. She was unaware of what she said.
Do you have experiences like that? Or
no? I do, or did, I put it that way. I did for about a period of about 5 years, and then I stopped. It became, I used to have people come here at 10 o'clock at night, and they wouldn't leave till maybe 6 or 7 o'clock the next morning. And in fact, once I think they came late at night, and I would say, I'm going to do it. I would use that word. And they would just get in cabs and come, and they would call their boss in the morning and say, we're not going to work today. And 10 people would be in this room, and it would be some of the most extraordinary experience of a lifetime. But then everybody was like living through me, do this, do that, do this. And it was amazing. We talked about people in history and as I said, extraordinary things happen.
How do you
happen.
Turn that off, though? Like, you have all
well, that was the problem, yes.
How do you push them
yes,
out?
Yes, that was where I was having a problem. Because as time was going on, I found myself I would be in a restaurant, and all of a sudden it was the, like, all hell would break loose in with me. And like one time I met His Holiness Taisi Tu Rinpoche. Now, if you don't know, we have a Pope and we have a Dalai Lama, we have cardinals, and we have Rinpoches. Rinpoche pretty much means the blessed one. So he would be like, you know, a cardinal in those terms. And so I met him. He stayed here at the house with several of his monks. And what happened was, I decided I was going to take him to this amazing dinner. So I called the head to the restaurant and I said, I am bringing with me the Rinpoche. And the guy was, wow, what an honor. And I said, I'll pay extra. Make the most beautiful table imaginable. Mm-hmm. Set it. And when we got to the restaurant, which no longer exists, it was Japanese, the table looked like a wedding cake. It was beautiful. It was all white with white flowers and white orchids. He must have told people because the place was very packed, and believe me, you could hear a pin drop. So there was His Holiness the Rinpoche, Taisi Tu, and then his teacher, who spoke no English, only Tibetan. And then there was the master, so to speak, who spoke Tibetan and spoke Sanskrit. So we were having this amazing dinner, and they were all going to come back to the house, and I was going to show him what I could do. And he said, oh, I've seen this many times, but it's always a fake. That's what he said.
And you showed him.
Well, so I said, really? He said, yes. He says, we don't believe it. I said, okay. I put my head down and went to town. Not only did I talk to him in Tibetan, which I know nothing. I couldn't say hello or goodbye. I think I do know, don't namaste. Everybody seems to know that. Namaste. And I began talking in Sanskrit. Now, he doesn't know Sanskrit. So the teacher, his teacher, had to translate Sanskrit to Tibetan because he doesn't speak English.
Okay.
And then from Tibetan, he would understand what I was saying. He couldn't even understand me, but the one did. And it was about where he was born. And then came the great statement of all and said, you are not sure, you do not believe, you doubt if you are the reincarnation of the Holy One that you are. And then this voice explained why he was and what it was. Quite a moving experience. And then after that, they went back to Tibet, and I never saw him again. Although every time somebody from America goes to the monastery and they meet with him, he says, did Frank say anything about me?
Well, and I get that. I think that people, when they come to you, they want to know about their future. They want to know what they can expect. And so a lot of times when people come in and they get a read with you, I'm sure you don't always tell them what they want to hear.
Well, that happened today. There was a lady who sat here, and it actually happened. And it wasn't going to work. I said to her, I don't want to do this. I said, because I can't tell you what you want to hear, and I don't want to hurt her. She was an elderly woman. And she said, when can I come back? And I said, oh, I don't know, give me a year. And she like that. And I said, all right, come back if you want in 3 months. But I know it wasn't going to work out. It was about love. It was about somebody that she was hoping to have a relationship with. And I just didn't see it. So I'm not going to hurt her. So I thought, go, just leave, you know. And she had never had a reading before. And she said, can I pay you? I said, no, I don't want your money. Just go. I said, I did nothing for you. And I let her go. You know,
that was nice of you. I mean, not to.
Well, I mean, if I feel I don't help anybody, then I what's the point? And as I said, it didn't never started out that it was going to be my career. So what happened was I was just reading for my friends.
Right.
And then I might say something. You're going to have to beep if I swear.
It's okay. No, it's YouTube. We don't have to.
Okay. So what happened was I was reading for everybody, my friends, and they all said, oh, but you know me. I said, I know you, but I love cards. I love tarot cards. I said, but this is what it said. So I said, okay. I was living on Perry Street in those days, and so I knocked on the door of the young man. I've seen him in the hall, and I knew his name was Bernie, but I knew nothing about him. So I knocked on his door, and he was home, and I said, Bernie, I said, I'm studying cards. Could I read your cards? And he said, which was a turning point in my life, he said, I have nothing going on right now. He said, but why don't you read the guy downstairs? Maybe you can help him. I said, okay. Now, the young man who lived on the lower floor was very handsome, very arrogant. When he'd see me in the hall, he'd slam the door and run in. I guess he was nervous about me for some reason. Well, no, I don't think he knew what I did, because nobody did, really. I was just doing it for friends. So he comes up, and his name was Adam, and he sat there, and Bernie sat here, let's say, but this is in Perry Street. And then I had two friends with me who were sitting here, which I've learned never to do that again. So we lay out the cards, and this is what changed my life. I said, wow, you're going on a trip to Canada. You're taking with you an older woman, and she is going to have an abortion. Well, he got up, and every four-letter word he could think of did he scream at me. And he yelled at Bernie, and he said, you bastard, you had to tell him, you had to say something, you couldn't keep your mouth shut. And the kid ran out and slammed the door. And everybody was, I was stunned. First of all, nobody ever yelled at me. My parents didn't even yell at me, let alone some stranger. And everybody was like, speechless. We didn't know what to say.
Right.
So Bernie said, how did you do that? I said, well, I just read what it said. And he said, do it again. He was very smart. And I said, okay. By the way, he's one of the largest diamond dealer jewel or gems in the world. Yeah. In fact, one of his gems is so big, it was like one of the largest star sapphires in the world, that it's at the Museum of Natural History. So, wasn't at the time. He is now. So, well, we were all kids then. So anyway, I said, okay, this is the first, I said, he's going on a trip to Canada. And then I went on, he stopped me. He said, wait a minute. He said, you just said the word Canada. I wasn't thinking. I said, yeah, I did. And he said, where do you see the word Canada? And I started laughing. I said, well, actually, it says he's going on a foreign trip. But when I looked at him, I saw the maple leaf. Now, being from Buffalo,
right,
when you cross the border, it's Canada. And I know that Canada, the symbol of Canada is the maple leaf. So I said, well, I just saw this symbol. Okay, finish. The next card was an older woman. He was 20, 21, maybe, 22. And the older woman, so I knew right away he was old. Then it said a baby, and it said the loss of the baby and tears. So I put it together. I said, oh, she's going to have an abortion. It took me a long time later, and I realized why he got mad, because in those days, abortions were totally illegal.
Right.
And he probably thought I was going to tell the police. I think that's why he reacted. But I knew at that point that this, what I just had done at that moment, at that table, that opened up a door within me, and it's called a key. It doesn't happen all the time. But when it does happen, whoa, even I have to wonder, where is it coming from?
So you didn't go to, so no one really taught you, you just kind of
did. Oh, no.
Like, no, you didn't that, have
no,
teachers?
I did, no, I did. Just, yes, I know. So at that point, I realized I had to learn more about this, because this was too dangerous in more ways than one. I mean, it's like the Ouija board. I tell people, stay away from the Ouija board, because you don't know what's going to happen.
Right.
Really, you could open up something really bad, so don't get into it.
So who are some of your inspirations that taught you?
So that's what I'm about to say. So what happened was, I then went to a bookstore where I bought my original book, and I asked them, and they said, oh, there's a wonderful lady who teaches. Her name is Rala Nordic. And I called her up, and I went to see her, and she began showing me the meanings of each one and putting it together. And like giving me an alphabet. And so she looked at me and said, at one point, she said, you know, it's very interesting about you. She said, you catch on so fast. Every time whatever I tell you, you seem to know. It's like you've heard it before. Well, it all made sense, you see. So little by little, you know, I began putting all the pieces together, and also it's combinations. It's not just one or two. This is where most people fail when they do a reading. You have to kind of look at the whole picture. For example, the minor, in the tarot cards, there's a major deck and a minor deck. The major is really the psychological. Most people don't want to hear about that. They don't want to hear my boyfriend's bipolar. They don't want to know why am I going crazy. They just, will I make that money? Will I win an Academy Award? So that's the fortune-telling aspect of this work. They all want to know that. They don't care about, you know, yeah, my father and mother hated me and that's why I hate the world. No, they don't want to hear about that. You know, am I going to get the job? Am I going to get married? Will I have kids? All right. So those are what they call the minor cards, and they're four suits. They somewhat correspond to if you were playing cards. In our regular deck, there are four suits, okay? And that was changed along the way by an English knight. He thought that let's say start with the wand or magic wand. So he made it a club, which, by the way, is a penis. It's not a fleur-de-lis like most people think. And then he took the cup card, which obviously is all about love, and he made that a heart, okay? And then he took the swords, and he changed it to the spade, which is actually the head of a spear. And then the last, which is the pentacle, which is a diamond, that's not a diamond ring. It's actually an arrowhead, you see, but most people think it's a diamond. And because it's funny, because that the pentacles are all about money. So most people want to hear that. And that's kind of, you know, that's what I have to give them.
Now, when you give a reading, I don't know if they're half hour, hour, 2 hours.
They're usually about an hour long. They're an hour. Sometimes if I get a live wire, then I do it a lot longer. It's like, whoa, I don't want to stop. Right. And then there are others I wish I could stop after 5 minutes. You know, it depends on the individual. Everybody's different.
Right. When did you realize that you could actually make a career and a living doing this?
Well, what happened was I was not living here at the time. Okay, I was still in the village. And as I said, I read only for friends. And apparently somebody, one of my friends, must have been talking about me in a supermarket. And this woman called me on the phone. And she said, I understand you read cards. And I said, yes. And she said, would you read my cards? And I said, well, you know, like, you know, I thought, oh my God, it's a stranger. You know, I said, okay. And she said, I'll pay you. I said, all right. So when she came over, it was another one of these turning points in my life. She had been haunted by a man that actually tried to kill her. And he was arrested and put in an insane asylum, but he had escaped. And she had a feeling. She was very sensitive. She was Pisces. Pisces, Cancer, and Scorpio. Those are the ones who are, you know, out in the twilight zone. So she had every good cause to believe that. So she came over to my apartment. She walked up the 5 flights and she sat there. And I must have read till 2 o'clock in the morning.
Wow.
I wouldn't stop. It was the most amazing experience for both of us. And I said, okay, if he's going to come and kill you, it'll be by midnight tonight. So it was past midnight. I said, good. They actually did catch him. So she was safe. But I could see where she thought. Well, she and I began a really strong friendship for a long time. And she paid me $5 for about 4 or 5 hours of reading, which is fine. I was just thrilled to do it. And so she said, every week I give these dinner parties, and I would love for you to come. And it turned out she lived a couple blocks away from me on West 11th Street. So I said, fine. So I went there on Wednesday, and it was a scene out of a movie. The table was this long table, beautiful dishes, except none of them matched, and some glasses were not the same, and some were Waterford, some were expensive, and the silverware was all, and it was sort of like the Mad Tea Party in Alice in Wonderland, and her children, one wore a top hat and a long black cape and a cane, and her daughter looked like little Alice. It really was amazing, and I read for these incredible people, and that's when I met my very first celebrity. In fact, he opened the door when I rang the doorbell. His name was Robert Graves, very famous writer, you know, poet and scholar, really. And it was interesting experience for me to meet him. I mean, this was like the Encyclopedia Britannica, you know, standing in front of me. And he began questioning me on things he knew I would not know. He talked about Julius Caesar as if he just had dinner with him the night before. He was so familiar with customs and with happenings and events. Like, you know, he would say in 5 BC, you know, in 20 AD. I mean, it was amazing, you know. I had a clue. And I just went along with the program. He didn't like me very much. And at the end, I could feel that he didn't like me. And I said, you know, I know why you really don't like me. And he looked at me and I said, your theory, I'm practice. I said, one day I will be theory, but you'll never be practice. Oh, that was like telling Spielberg, I'm going to make a better movie than you. Anyway, it was okay. And since, you know, years went by and he went back to Spain where he lived in a place called Dea. And I know whenever anybody was going to Spain, I said, you got to go there, because just go meet him because he's incredible. He would talk about, you know, as I said, Julius Caesar, Cleopatra. He did one of the original translations of I, Claudius. He gets credit for that. And God knows how many other things. And he also did a study of the trees of Ireland. Like, they didn't have months like we had. They were named after trees, you know, sacred trees. And like, you would never cut an oak tree down. It was punishable by death. And he talked about why these plants and trees, what they meant at that time. And there were like 13 months, not 12. And the 13th month would have been the worst month of the year because it was the coldest. You see, and we always think of 13 as bad luck. And people will say, well, that's because of the 12 apostles and Jesus. No, it goes back further than that. I mean, if you were born in the 13th month, ooh, that's not a good month to be born in, and so on. Well, he was like the first. And then so I read for her guests. They each paid me $5. And then through time, they came to see me, and other people came, and before you know it, the phone was ringing, and it was ringing. But I always worked. I had jobs. I did everything from worked at the Museum of Natural History. I worked in real estate, which that's how I found my apartment in the village. It was $52.36 a month rental.
Not gonna find that now in the village.
Yeah, and I was in the office, so I heard it come in, so I grabbed it, and then I worked market research. I worked on Wall Street for a year. That was definitely not me, but it was it. And when I went to quit, wherever I quit, they always offered me more money, you know. And they didn't want me to leave because they thought they said, you're so clever.
Well, what made you want to just do this? Just
I didn't. It happened. It was like I fell into it. I mean, you know, the phone would ring and the phone would ring and the phone would ring. So I decided that I was going to just do this work.
Now, you do know a lot of celebrities and you have read for a lot of celebrities. We talked about John Lennon and Yoko Ono.
Well, I'm not going to talk about the ones that are still alive because...
That's fine.
Yeah, because they've actually said, please don't, because people make fun of them. I mean, that's like, all right, everybody knew that Nancy Reagan and Ronald Reagan... had their astrologer. And nobody said anything until Nancy drove them crazy, and then they made fun of her. You see, now they kind of were, because she's gone, they don't say much. Poor Clinton, his wife, Hillary, she had somebody from Texas, I think the woman was from, who was like a Chandler. And when they found out, boy, they let them have it. So movie stars and a lot of them, some people don't care.
Right. You know?
But I have had a few stars come here and they say, look, I'm very angry because the psychic used me several times, you know, my name, and I don't think that's right.
Right.
So unless they say to me, it's okay, or I'm dead, I don't care what you do at that point. So I'm in, I can't believe it, but I'm putting together, let's say, a portfolio of things, and I'm in 17 books.
It's a good thing.
Yeah. as long as they talk about me, then that's different.
Right, and Andy Warhol did a portrait of
him. He did a portrait, right. That's upstairs.
And we're going to take a look at Frank's art, and Frank is also going to give a reading so you can actually watch and see how it works and what happens. And so we will take a quick break, and then we'll come back.
All right, now what I want you to do is with your left hand, you're right-handed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with your left hand. See, we take the one that you don't write with, which is the unconscious. In your case, it's the left hand.
Mm-hmm.
It works on the right side of the brain. Make three piles.
Okay.
And just relax. Let's have fun. Come on.
All right, three piles.
Yeah, three.
They better be good piles.
Yeah, they better be good. Yeah, I can't take any more bad news. Just divide them into three piles. No, because a lot of people are calling me and saying, I want to come see you. I love you, but if you bring me more bad news, I'll just jump off a bridge, you know? No, okay. It's difficult. It's just, you know, I mean, every time you turn on the TV, it's like, oh, no, who's, you know, who just set off a bomb again? You know, it's crazy.
That's why I don't turn on the TV.
Yeah, no, really, you can't watch the news. It's just awful. All right, now, with both hands, you shuffle each stack separately. Start with that one. Just mix it up like this. Yeah, you can't do the Western way because they're too old and broken. Yeah, these cards are, as I said, they're probably over 50 years old. I mean, everybody, Princess Grace of Monaco, Yoko Ono, John Lennon, Perry Ellis.
My goodness.
Warhol never had a reading. He was too scared. He wouldn't do it. Yeah, he wouldn't do it. Yeah, yeah.
Did you tell him anything he didn't want to know?
Well, I'll tell you what did happen. All right, put them back into one stack with the left hand. What happened was, after the portrait, they brought it down here. He brought it with Mrs. Miller, Chantel Miller. They own all the duty-free shops in the world. Yeah, got the picture. And lovely, she was really lovely. So anyway, they brought the picture down, and then we went to the Odeon for dinner. And I had another deck, which I sometimes give people cards. So I reached in like this, and I just pulled out any card, and I wrote to Andy, love Frank Andrews, and we went to dinner. So at the he was sitting opposite me, and there was myself, an actor friend of mine, the guy that introduced us, who was his worker. Andy had two or three friends. And there was a Pilates expert with us. And anyway, so I slid the card across like this, and he looked at it, and he looked at me, and then he put it away, and that was the last time I saw him, and it was the death card.
Oh.
Yeah, that's what he didn't want to hear.
But that doesn't always mean death, does it?
It doesn't. It usually means, because somebody said, why'd you give it to him? I said, well, it does mean a new beginning.
Yeah.
But in fact, it rarely means that. But in that dramatic moment, that's what it meant.
Yeah.
Yeah, 9 out of 10 times, you never say death.
Right.
You'd have to have a combination of things. Yeah. I didn't even think that until after,
right,
you know.
Right.
All right. Okay, the first one, I'm going to just read words. All right, because it's fascinating, and they're not that bad, so don't worry.
Okay. I'm not that
don't,
bad.
Well, no, don't panic. Well, no, like this is working on a project.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's what that says.
Mm-hmm.
This one is the card for communication.
Okay.
Hear that?
Mm-hmm.
This one is politics and diplomacy. So in other words, if there's something you want that you want to do,
mm-hmm.
you say, and I'm not talking about just like a regular job, obviously, something outside of it. In other words, you're going to have to be very diplomatic. And this one is Gemini. I don't know if you know anything about the zodiac, but it means communication. So this is all about probably you, people say, oh, you're talking about networking.
Mm.
See, in other words, you can't. This is not a time I'm going to go to the country and I'm going to meditate. No. You stay in the city. Let's make this thing happen.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
You hear that?
Yep.
Okay, this is love. All right, hear that?
Mm-hmm.
So that means there's going to be love in your life. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean just for the project,
yeah.
Oh, which does look good, but that's usually a person.
Okay.
So you're not going to be alone.
Okay, hallelujah. That's good.
Yeah. And this one, oh, that's the best card you can get. That's wish granted in a happy way. No, that really is like, let's go to Las Vegas. Really, that's like the best one. And, okay, and do you know anything about Pisces?
I'm a Pisces.
Well, it says, Pisces will get wish granted in a happy way. That's Pisces, yeah. That's, yeah, the moon represents Pisces. See, and it's next to the Nine of Cups. You know, even if, let's say, well, you don't want to ever walk into a gypsy storefront. You do that, the first thing they say is, oh, there's a curse on you. No, they're the curse. Then they, I don't want any money, but then they ask for $1,000 for lighting candles. No, but a real gypsy, I'm talking about the real ones,
yeah.
If they were to do this, they, even if they change the meanings, they never change this one. They could. They won't read the tarot cards. Everybody thinks they read tarot cards. They don't. They read regular cards. And this would be the Nine of Hearts. This is the Nine of Cups. Same thing. And it means wish granted. And this one is Pisces. See? Now, Pisces is very sensitive. They're out there. They're, you know, really, they're out in the twilight zone.
Well, you don't have to tell me.
Yeah, exactly. So what you have to do is like, okay, when you go in and it looks like you're going to be talking to a committee of men, and you're a woman, you got to be strong. You follow? And you have to really, everything you got in you, use it. All right? Isn't that fun? But it does say, working on a project now. This is about communication. This is also the computer. See, everything to do with the mail, packages, airplanes, the cell phone, that's Gemini. Things in the air. See, and you have to use that. So maybe you gotta use the computer. It seems like that's a way of life for everybody these days. I'm probably the only one who doesn't need one. So I have
lucky
an iPad. Well, you know, it's the way it is now. Everything is so different. But isn't that funny? The outcome is Pisces. It's everything is up to you. In other words, if you're gonna do it, you gotta do it. Nobody's gonna do it for you. All right, let's do another spread. All right.
Sounds good. I have that philosophy that if I want to do it, I'm going to do it.
Well, Pisces is also imagination. See, that's the thing. You know, it's like, let's say if, like some of the signs, let's say Virgo. If Virgo was going to paint a horse, it would be so beautiful and so detailed. Like, wow.
Yeah.
Okay. And now Scorpio is going to paint a horse, and it's a beautiful horse, and it's running into the ocean, and it keeps going until it drowns. See, it's that drama.
Yeah.
You know, you know. And Pisces, that horse is running along the water, and all of a sudden the wings come out, and it flies. That's Pisces.
Yeah.
See, it's that imagination. Yeah. Funny, as I'm saying that, it's funny, I see you surrounded by paintings. Yeah, something about paintings. Maybe you're going to go where there are a lot of artworks and paintings. Yeah.
Interesting.
Now, make two stacks with your left hand. And shuffle each stack separately. Okay, pick one. Okay, all right, let's see what we got here. God, they're so old, they stick. All right, I've used so much scotch tape. It's funny, because the center of the cards are clearer because of the tape.
You always use these cards?
Yeah. If I travel, I don't take them out of the house. Okay. This is the past, and it's about a struggle. You struggling. And this is about a woman that you might have worked with. It's the domineering bitch. Usually, you know. Yeah. So
I can't wait for this to go.
So, yeah. Look, you know what? Let's look at it this way. Let's look at it this way. If you survive that, you can survive anything. Okay. Yeah. And it's interesting because I also felt she's going to be somebody who's going to pretend to be so sweet and so nice, and that cha-chow comes out. Yeah. But that's the past.
Yes.
That's over.
Yes.
Okay. So hopefully, I love the outcome. It says you triumph. Mm-hmm. You see, in other words, look, you're still here. You didn't lose your brain. You know, she didn't drive you. You didn't jump off a bridge. Mm-hmm. But people like that, you stay a while. I mean, if you were a kid, she could destroy somebody. And I bet she has. I bet she has. All right, so we're moving into the present line. Today, that's the card for sunshine and happiness. See? Oh, California, here you come. You're going out to California. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, I don't know about you moving there, but I do think going there is really good. All right? Now, there's a guy out there, okay, mm-hmm. and involved in art, music, drama. Hear that? Maybe motion picture. Hooray for Hollywood. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is California, and this usually means soon. See, so you may be going out that way. But I think you should go, but come back.
I just came from there.
Oh, you what?
But I may be going back.
You may be going back, yeah. But I don't want you living there. I think to go there or to work there would be great, and then get back here. You're not a California. You really want to die?
California.
Move down to Florida. That'll kill you. Yeah, live in a gated community.
Right.
Yeah. Well, oh! Frank, what'd you tell her? She's an alcoholic. Well, she's in Florida. What do you want from me? No, yeah, you're a New Yorker. Come on. Where are you going to go? I don't mind you. If you said I'm going for 5 days, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
If you're going down to Florida for 5 days, well, that's beautiful. You right. know? All right. But there's some. But if you met anyone, by the way, when you were in California, like a guy, I don't like him. See, this means trouble.
Okay.
But that, again, is out there.
Okay.
All right. Now we're going further to the future. Mm-hmm. The top card, the dreamer, the fool. Can you see these cards in there?
A little bit.
I'll hold some of them up. Because, see, this card, when I said California, it usually means a distant trip in the country we're living in right now. Like if I was in, let's say, in England, and we were in London, I might say, oh, you're going all the way down, I don't know the map, but going all the way down to the south.
Right.
See, so it means you're going a distant trip, and if you notice when I talk, sometimes you'll see me, I stare, you know, and I saw the shape of California.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I saw Hollywood here, this is the card for art, music, drama, it's got to be California.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, up here, it talks about being involved with someone. Okay.
Okay.
It does say love and affection.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And I love it. It says the dream. Somehow, if I can get you not to worry, you could have a great relationship. But see, you're Pisces. They're so sensitive. You know, be sensitive like the baby, the dog, the flower. But, you know, you got to be strong now. Because especially if you're going to want to put this project across, you have to be really tough. I love the top one, going for the dream. See, the fool. You know, when I quit that job, think about this. When I quit that job, I was telling you earlier, everybody told me I was crazy. I was making a lot of money. And that was the 60s, and I was making a lot of money. And in fact, sometimes I don't even make that, you know, now. And people told me I was a fool. I was crazy. Nobody's going to believe that. Well, I don't know, 55 years later, I don't think I did so bad. You know,
yeah.
So it's the same thing. Yeah. Don't look back. Let's go for it. Go for your dream.
Awesome.
Okay?
That's great. Thank you.
Isn't that interesting? Awesome. Yeah. This is a photograph of me. I have more upstairs of my aura, and I have one of my little dogs with me.
Oh, neat.
Yeah, that I used to have little dogs years ago. And this was done by a very brilliant artist by the name of Ken Tisa. He did this, and Keith Haring spotted it, and you could see the influence that Keith Haring got from that. Up here, this is a napkin. Andy Warhol was famous for signing napkins and giving them to the waiter. In fact, one was on eBay that it sold for $40,000. So I guess that's the biggest tip that the waiter ever got.
Yeah.
And a woman came here and she saw that and screamed and she said, "That's my napkin." I said, "Your napkin."
Oh, wow. How neat.
It's her restaurant. It was a birthday party. And it's
1980, September 27th, 1980.
Yeah. And so all the guests, I wasn't there, a friend of mine gave it to me.
How did Andy Warhol come to find you?
Well, as I said, one of my friends did the introduction. He told Andy wanted to do my portrait before he met me. He met me and then he wanted to do it, but I didn't have the money to pay for it. But I had. At that time, lithographs by John Lennon that Yoko Ono had given me, and he wanted them. So I gave him the lithographs, and then he in turn did the portrait. So.
Great shot of Marilyn.
That's an original photograph of Marilyn. Taken by Bert Stern before she died, shortly after died. This is when I first came to New York. I wanted to be a pantomimist. This is a portrait of Marcel Marceau. I wanted to be like him. That's my portrait that he did. I was taken on my birthday in 1974 in Osaka.
She seems like an interesting lady.
She is. Yes. She definitely is an interesting woman. This was one of my longest house guests. This was Dorothy Herzog. She used to write for Randolph Hearst. Randolph Hearst, you know, was the big tycoon back in the 1910-1920 era, and she used to write for, she had a column, she was a movie columnist, and she was good friends with his mistress, who was a lady by the name of Marion Davies. If you saw the movie Citizen Kane, it's based on Hearst, and in the movie there's a man who's a reporter, played by Joseph Cotten, who gets fired because he wrote a bad review about Citizen Kane's mistress, who was in the movie an opera singer, but in real life she was an actress. Well, Doris used to write those reviews, so he blacklisted Doris. And in the movie, the guy gets blacklisted and couldn't get a job. So because she couldn't get work, she, on this typewriter, okay, was
an awesome typewriter.
She had to write a book for money. And this is the contract. It's a mimeograph sheet. It was written out on October 29th, 1929, the day the stock market crashed. And the book that she wrote is...
Wow, Some Like It Hot.
Some Like It Hot. Yeah, she wrote a book called Some Like It Hot. Yeah. Back in 1929, the truth was she was, oh, this is these are pictures here of my aura. What I did was an experiment. The girl that was taking the pictures, I would say now, because I would try to change the colors, you see? And you could see, and see how different the colors are?
Yeah, it's interesting.
Isn't that interesting?
Can you see auras? Can you see people's
only,
auras?
Only on some people, but very rarely, though. Very rarely. Very rare. It just happens sometimes, but it's one of those things. And then, I don't know if you want to see, this is my bedroom.
Let's go look at the bedroom. Yeah. Where all the creativity happens.
Yeah, this is where I sleep. Take a look out this window. It's spectacular for New York City. Imagine.
Right by the church.
That's the original St. Patrick's Cathedral. As I said, this used to be an Irish neighborhood. And then they moved out and the Italians moved in. They're repairing the church, doing an amazing job. It needs it. It's over 200 years old. It first they started building it in 1809.
It's just great. I really appreciate you letting us
it's wonderful.
Sneak in your bedroom and look at all your art. And
yeah, well, you know, I sort of stopped collecting. I'm tired now. Now I'm starting to give away, so that's what happens when you get older. Start giving things away.
Okay.
Mary had a little lamb.